الحمد لله هب كفى والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا صدق الله العلي العظيم salawat durud as-salatu was-salamu alayka ya rasulullah wa ala alika wa sahbika ya sayyidi ya habibullah my respected and honorable brother and sheikh brother Nazim Bakh sahib the hazrat qari sahib whose name I don't know and my dear brothers and sisters assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh we have gathered here today to commemorate the occasion of Karbala, Muharram, and specifically talk about Ahlul Bayt. Initially, I had this topic in mind, which was prophets and philosophers. So if I would say something about that, and inshallah, we'll talk about Ahlul Bayt, we'll talk about Hazrat Sayyida Fatima Zahra, Imam Ali, Imam Hassan, and Imam Hussein, inshallah. Since we live in this Western country, all of us, we have children, and I think it's always important for me to talk something about that, something relevant for the current times, so, and then inshallah we'll speak about the Ahlul Bayt. Are you all with me, everybody? Okay. You know the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first one is Hazrat Adam alayhi salam, and the last one is obviously Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, when these prophets, they come to the world and they invite people to Islam. They come and they say, Ya ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. People, come to Islam, come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the basis upon which they invite people to Islam, to the deen, the basis is very much, the justification of it is very much based on an epistemological basis. So it's the source of knowledge that the prophets are claiming that they have, which the other people don't have. So when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, or when Ibrahim alayhi salam, he comes and he says, Ya abat inni qad ja'ani min al-ilmi, O my dear uncle or father, you know, indeed it has come to me from knowledge. Fattabi'ni, follow me, and I will ahdika siratan sawiya. I will guide you to the straight path. So the basis on which Ibrahim alayhi salam and other prophets, on the basis on which they invited people to religion, was on the basis of ilm, on the basis of knowledge. Now, what kind of knowledge are we talking about here? What is the difference between the knowledge of a prophet and the knowledge of ordinary human beings, of the knowledge of the scientists, of the knowledge of the philosophers? What is the difference between these two knowledges? Because the claim is based on this kind of special knowledge. Now, you know there are different types of knowledge, okay? There is like the material knowledge, there is the gnostical knowledge, which you guys are, alhamdulillah, one day attained, the Sufis. The gnostical knowledge, there is the unseen knowledge, there is the spiritual knowledge. So knowledge can be of many types. So what kind of knowledge are we talking about? When Ibrahim alayhi salam, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam says that to follow us on the basis of this knowledge that we have, what kind of knowledge is that? Now for that, let us just quickly investigate. We will, inshallah, reach to Ahlul Bayt, but this is the message of Ahlul Bayt. So what kind of knowledge? What kind of knowledge are the prophets basing their claim upon? Is that sort of clear so far? Right? Okay. So when we look at the knowledge, knowledge from the aspect of materialistic sources of knowledge, in other words, knowledge for us as human beings, we see that our knowledge falls into two categories, direct knowledge or indirect knowledge. Direct, yani, immediate knowledge. And indirect knowledge is mediate knowledge. So the knowledge that we as human beings have, it comes from two types of sources, bilwasta and bilawasta. You know, the direct knowledge and indirect knowledge. The direct knowledge that we have as human beings, the direct knowledge we have is intuition, for example, is three types, you know. So the direct knowledge is three types, intuition, nature, and priority extemporization. So intuition is, for example, the feeling of being. At this moment in time, you know, I know, that we are alive. This feeling of being alive is intuition. It's just, so this is direct knowledge. I mean, no one needs to tell me that, Hasnain, you are living, you know. I know it directly that I'm alive. The second type of knowledge is nature, which is also direct. The flying of the birds, the swimming of the fish. The fish don't go to a swimming pool, man, to go and learn how to fish. Or the birds don't go to the learning flying center to learn how to fly. It is in their nature. So that is the direct knowledge that we have as human beings also. The third type of direct knowledge is priority extemporization. I had to actually coin this. But the thing is, it's the feeling of hunger, feeling of thirst, the feeling we have. You know, I am thirsty. I'm hungry. We are hungry. This is also community. We know it directly. We don't need any sources. It's internally this knowledge we have, direct knowledge. So the point here is that as human beings, when you study yourself, when we look at ourselves, we find there are two types of knowledges that we have. We have a knowledge that is direct, that is the three types that we've just talked about. And then there's the knowledge we have which is indirect. And that is ilm bil ihsas and ilm bil aql. So ilm bil ihsas, the knowledge, the indirect knowledge that we have is through the senses. So we have, how many senses do we have? Five senses. So we have the sense of sight, of hearing, of taste, of smell, of touch. When our senses perceive the external world, when they perceive, this is called knowledge with the senses. And when these five senses present their knowledge to our akal, to our reason, to our faculty of reasoning, when the senses present their knowledge to the faculty of reasoning, then we may call this ilm bil akal, the knowledge with intellect. But when the prophets say, follow us because we have this knowledge, we don't mean this kind of knowledge. We don't mean the knowledge that comes through these sources, my dear brothers and sisters. We mean the knowledge that the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attain from behind the curtains of the unseen. We mean the knowledge that is wahi, that is revelation, that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sources of that knowledge is not the senses, it's not the intelligence, it is a totally different channel of information. And it's on this basis that the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called people to Islam, because their claim is that our knowledge is not from these senses and direct and indirect knowledge, but our knowledge is the wahi, is revelation. I hope, is all this making sense to you, right, so far? Alhamdulillah, okay. So this is what's going on here. Now, when we look at the knowledge of the human beings and the knowledge of, you know, the prophets, of prophets are human beings, but what I mean is the ordinary human beings, right? So when we look at it, we see that there are various types of knowledge that we as human beings, we get. There's kinds of knowledge. For example, there is al-hikmah, yani, yes? Hikmah is ilmun yubhathu fihi an haqa'iq al-ashya ala ma hiya alay fil wujud biqadri taqat al-bashari. Tafahm, Sheikh? So, the thing is, Hikmah is the knowledge that we get. Yubhas ilm is, yubhas fihi is a knowledge which discusses the reality of things according to the limitations of a human being. So what actually happened was that when people looked at these other forms of knowledge, they confused it that these sources are also similar to that of the prophets. But that is not true. So, for example, al-fikr, definition of thought. I hope I'm making sense to you. But inshallah ta'ala, I'm sure the things will become clearer. Al-fikr is thought. Have you ever thought what the definition of thought is? You know, it says thought, fikr. The definition of thought is tartibu umurin ma'lumatin litaddi ila majhul, meaning that we have a set of known values and we study a set of known values and we organize them and we reach ila al-majhul, an unknown value. I'll give you an example. For example, we have the idea of mountain, right? Simple idea is a mountain. So we've seen mountains. You have lots of mountains in Canada, right? We over there have Ben Nevis, which is like nothing, man, compared to your mountains. So the thing is, we have an idea of a mountain. And then we also have an idea of gold, okay? So we have a simple idea of mountain, and we have another simple idea, for example, gold, right? Now, these are two known values that we have, gold and mountain. But then our fikr, what it does is it mixes them two and gives us a third value, golden mountain. So originally we have set of known values and we sort of mix them up through our imagination and create another value of golden mountain. So the problem is, I'm omitting this whole big thing, but I come to this example for you. The point I'm trying to make to you is this, that the knowledge of this type and the knowledge of the type that human beings attain is very limited knowledge. It's very dependent knowledge. Knowledge is partial knowledge. And the knowledge that the prophets have is a total and absolute knowledge. Their knowledge is different. Our knowledge is, is very partial. You know, for example, you have there's a famous example for children who are here. There was three blind men, and they were there was a big elephant in a hole somewhere. The three blind men were to test it, what kind of animal it is. So these three blind people, one touched the trunk of the elephant, the other touched the feet of the elephant, and the other person who's standing, he touched the back of the elephant. Now, the idea they got of the elephant, one man says, oh, this elephant is like a column. The other says, no, this is like a pillar. I mean, a flat. So whatever part of the elephant these people touched, they thought that this is the full picture, this is the whole elephant. And this is the problem that scientists and philosophers, great they are, I have no doubt about their, abilities, but the questions of life, the questions of our ultimate problems, life is an activity, and every activity with it brings two kinds of problems. You've got the problems, the immediate problems, and you've got the ultimate problems. The immediate problems are the problems of our daily life, the work, job, family, children, the whole thing there, right? That's the immediate problems. But the ultimate problems are the problems of this life, the purpose and meaning of our life. Where has this world come from? And the questions of that nature. Now, the prophets come to address those questions, the questions about meaning and purpose of our life. And on the other side, you have the knowledge, the sources of our knowledge that are temporal, that are partial. They are unable, this knowledge is unable to give us a complete answer to the meaning and purpose of our life. We as human beings are part of this planet. We are part of this planet. And in turn, this planet is part of our galaxy. And our galaxy, in turn, is part of the universe. So a human being is part of the organic world. The organic world plus the inorganic world is part of the Earth. The Earth, in its turn, is part of this our solar system. And then our solar system is part of the galaxy. And the galaxy, in turn, is part of the universe. So in other words, a single human being is part of this larger whole. And there's a rational principle in philosophy that to know the whole, the part, we must know the whole. To have the knowledge of the whole, we must know the whole to have the knowledge of the part. If I come into this building and I only look at the entrance, I don't know what's inside. I didn't know there was a big, you know, conference center here. There was a masjid in there. So the human beings, to know the meaning, destiny, the constitution, and the purpose of mankind, of human being, we are part of this universe. So to know the meaning of the part, we must know the meaning of the whole. And here, my dear brothers and sisters, is where the sources of knowledge that we have are unable to answer to these questions. And for the information of my young children and my brothers and sisters, the philosophers themselves say, you know, the journey of this life, from beginning to end, you cannot do this journey on the bus of doubt. You need the plane of certainty. You cannot do this journey, my dear brothers and sisters, on a sinking ship of doubt, but you need the ship of salvation. Philosophers, my dear brothers and sisters, themselves, they themselves say, I mean, I find it, it's my first time in Canada, obviously. I just stopped there. It's my first time here. And obviously, I don't know the, you know, you don't know how we deal with things, and I don't know who you deal with things. But I believe that the last couple of days, the feedback that I've had, that, you know, alhamdulillah, it's I'm making sense to you. So I hope I am making sense to you here.
Alhamdulillah.
So the point is that, you know, we're looking at the sources of knowledge. So the knowledge of human beings, our knowledge is different to the knowledge that the prophets have. The knowledge that the scientists and the philosophers have is great knowledge, but that knowledge, the sources of it are insufficient to provide us with the information about the purpose, the meaning of our life. Because their knowledge is limited knowledge. Their knowledge is partial knowledge. And philosophers themselves, they themselves say that we don't know anything. The philosophers themselves claim, for example, you know, you ask this guy, Californian Observatory, some director there, asked him that, you know, how is this universe, you know, designed and arranged? And he says that, this scientist says that the book of this universe is arranged in such a way that the first and the last pages of this book of universe is missing. This is an admission by the scientists themselves. Henri Bergson, the famous French philosopher, we asked him, can you tell us how, if philosophy and reason is sufficient for our life? And he says, rationality and reason alone is limited and dependent. And when you try to seek the answers to the ultimate questions, then this reason is insufficient. These are admissions by the philosophers themselves. Hegel, the great materialistic philosopher, he says that we are far from reality, as the Romans were 2,000 years ago, Spinoza 200 years ago, and Newton 100 years ago. Newton himself says that I am like a fisherman walking on the beach, picking up the shells, and I don't know which shell contains the pearls in it, my dear brothers and sisters. And the Imam of all philosophers, the Imam of all of them, Socrates, the Sheikh is smiling because he knows what that is. He says, I know this, that I know nothing. So the philosophers themselves, my dear brothers and sisters, they have admitted, they are in admission that we don't know. We cannot help you with the ultimate reality. But on the other side, we have the prophets. See the difference between the two. If one says that the distance from here to the end of this hole is 60 meters, the other says, no, the distance from here to the end is 100 meters. But the one who says it's 100 meters measures it with a measuring instrument. Who is right? The one who measures it with an instrument. Because that is the purpose. That is the true knowledge of this. So this is the difference between the prophets. The philosophers say that the skies are the limit. The prophets say, no, no. I visited the skies on the night of my miraj.
Allahu Akbar.
The philosophers say that it's darkness in the grave. The prophets say, no, no. It won't be darkness in the grave. I will be there. It'll be brightness.
Allah.
The Hume says that the death is a jump in the darkness. But the prophets say, no. After death, there is life.
Allah.
One says that this river Kawthar in Jannah is a myth. The prophet says, no, no, I am the guardian of it. And it is my tavern. So do you see that the claims from both groups of people who are trying to guide humanity, the claims of both are very, one is admitting we don't know, and the others are saying, yes, we do. We know. On this basis alone, any rational human being should see for the, okay. I was just beginning. Okay. Oh, I didn't realize the time. So however, the point is that I had to talk about the Ahlul Bayt, but this was, I think, very important. As you will know, the Sheikh, that, you know, the culture, the society that we're living in, our children are challenged every day on the basis of liberal education and rationality. And you need to have answers to these basic questions. And so that's why. So however, you see, my dear brothers and sisters, the difference between prophets and philosophers is that on one side, it's nur, and on the other side, it's darkness. On one side, my dear brothers and sisters, on one side is the intellectual death. On the other side is the spiritual life. On one side, my dear brothers and sisters, is the mutiny of philosophy. On the other side is the greatness of prophecy. On one side is decline of materialism. On the other side, my dear brothers and sisters, is everlasting rise of spiritualism.
Ameen.
On one side is ignorance of philosophy. On the other side is the greatness of prophecy. On one side is confused and muddled up cases. On the other side is plain and simple matters. On one side is Kant, Goethe, Newton. Ideology, on the other side, is Musa and Isa and Mustafa's theology. On one side is Kant and Machiavelli. On the other side is Hussein and Ali.
Allah.
And it is the day of Hussein today. What happened? Ahlul Bayt, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah Muhammad, say, La asalukum alayhi ajran. I do not illa al-mawaddata fil qurba. That, O Muhammad, qul, I'm saying to you, ask. Ask, I don't ask anything, any reward, any payment for my hardships, my hard work, and my propagation of Islam. Illa al-mawaddata fil qurba. Except that I want the love of Ahlul Bayt, of my qurba, of my nearest ones. Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, Tafsir al-Thalabi, who died in 427, for example, says, he asked Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, man qarabatukka haulai wajabat alayna alladhina wajabat alayna mawaddatuhum. Man qarabatukka haulai alladhina wajabat alayna mawaddatuhum. Who is this? Ibn Abbas says, Ya Rasulullah, we know they are your near ones, but man haulai, who are these people upon whom it's obligatory, wajib for us to love them? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam says, Fatima,
Allah,
Hassan,
Allah,
Hussein, and Ali. So, and that's why the great Imam Shafi'i, you know, my brothers, mashallah, recites really well. I will attempt reciting it. Imam Shafi'i says, Rahimahullah, Ya Ahla Bayti Rasulillahi Hubbukumu. Imam Shafi'i says, he died in 204, he goes, Ya Ahla Bayti Rasulillahi Hubbukumu. Fardhum minallahi fil Qur'an yanzalahu. Imam Shafi says, Yo Ahlul Bayt of Rasulullah, it is fard, wajib for us to love you. Where is it wajib in the Quran? This la asalukum alayhi ajran, illa al-mawaddada fil qurba. The Quran has made it obligatory upon us to love the five. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyida Fatima, Imam Ali, Hassan and Hussein. And my dear brothers and sisters, I'm finishing. I know you gave me a limited amount of time, but let me just quickly relate something to you. You know, when in the 61 after Hijrah, the Muharram of 61 after Hijrah, a man, an open drinker, you know, his history is full of it. During Hajj, he went to Hajj before he was sat on the throne, and the man was tipsy doing Arafah and Mina. He was drunk. Ibn Asir writes in Al-Kamil. Yazid used to have women, dancers, and boys, and drink. You know, this was his character. And he sat on the throne in charge of the 23 provinces of the Muslim world, having the power to change, distort our religion. Everybody listened to him. Everybody did his bayat by force, by money, by everything, but Hussein. Because Imam Hussein knew that I cannot give this man the legitimacy of being a ruler. Because as soon as Hussein alayhi salam does his bayat, that means that he is in charge of the entire Muslim ummah, and this drinking and dancing man, he will then totally destroy Islam. And you know, later on, this is clearly written, it's tawatur, I don't have time to go through with it, but the point is this, that ulama of Ahlus Sunnah are unanimous that Yazid was evil. And a considerable number of them even declared him as a non-Muslim. Sharul Aqaid, for example. So these people have, why? Because Yazid, his poetry, you know when they chopped the head of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, you know you see these terrorists today? They are the descendants, ideological descendants of Yazid. Allah. The first head to be cut in Islam and displayed on the lance was the head of Hussein. Allah. And what is happening today in Iraq again? Okay. Same head chopping is going on, my dear brothers and sisters. Because Imam Hussein was for love, and these people, Yazid, was of hate. And when these people at Karbala, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he went with his family. He didn't go there just on his own. He took his wives, his sisters, his daughter, his sons, his companions, all of them went to Karbala, out in the open. Out in the open to expose Yazid's bad ways. And they gave their life. They gave their life to safeguard Islam. You know, when Yazid was openly, when Imam Hussein's head was cut, he had a stick and he was hitting it. Hitting the son, the very head on which Rasulullah was kissing and Fatima Zahra was kissing. This man was in his court after the battle. He was hitting his head and he was saying, today we have avenged the death of my ancestors at Badr. What? Badr was Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam fighting the mushrikeen. And he goes, I have avenged my uncles, who Imam Ali killed, by the way. So he was doing that. And so the point I'm finishing now, the point is this. Who won the Battle of Karbala? What happened? Imam Hussein gave his life, gave his blood, but who won? Who won that battle? See, brothers and sisters, the victory and defeat does not depend on who was killed and who was the killer. The victory and defend, my dear brothers and sisters, depend. Victory and defeat depends on the objectives and aims of both. What was the objective of Hussein? What was the objective of Yazid? Yazid wanted that there should be no La ilaha illallah. There should be no Muhammad Rasulullah. There should be no Salah. There should be no Hajj. There should be no Islam. There should be no peace. And Hussein wanted that there would be Tawheed, there would be Risalat, there would be La ilaha illallah, there would be Muhammad Rasulullah. And in 1436 Hijrah, you are sitting here in Canada, praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, discussing Islam. Then shout with me, then know this, that Hussein won and Yazid lost. Imam Hussein gave his blood and safeguarded our religion and our Islam. My dear brothers and sisters, I finish with this word that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam says, that man ahabbal hasana wal husayna, whoever loves Hassan and Hussein loves me. So our love for Imam Hussein, you know, I find, Sheikh, I am a student, and mashallah, you guys are senior scholars. I really find this annoying sometimes, that, you know, the times are such that you can't even discuss Karbala. What? The people who saved the religion for you, the very basis that you're doing sajda today, it's strange that you can't even discuss about Imam Hussein. Oh, political. It's not political, man. It's to do with your iman. Rasulullah said about Imam Ali in Sahih Muslim, Ya Ali, hubbuka imanun wa bughzuka nifakun. Ya Ali, your love is iman and your hatred is nifak. Ahlul Bayt have been persecuted. Did you know, I've been finishing for the last 5 minutes, but I've been finishing now. Tadribu Ravi, just one reference and I'm sitting. You know, Ahlul Bayt have been persecuted throughout the centuries. The 12 Imams of Ahlul Bayt, right from Imam Ali, Hassan, Hussein, Zainul Abideen, Jafar al-Sadiq, Musa al-Kadhim, Ali al-Raza, Muhammad al-Taqi, by the way, Ali al-Naqi is my answer. Ali al-Naqi and Hassan al-Askari and Muhammad al-Mahdi is yet to come. All the Imams was killed. They were shaheed. Tadribul Ravi is a book by Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti. All the scholars who read about hadith, they read that book to add the principles of hadith. I give you just one thing. In there it says, "Kanat Banu Umayyata idha sami'u bimawludin ismahu Ali." That Banu Umayyah, when they heard that there's somebody child is named Ali, what did they used to do? Qataluhu. They used to kill him. This is in Tadribul Ravi. So my dear brothers and sisters, we have gathered here. I congratulate you to pay this homage to the Ahlul Bayt. Remember their pain, remember their sacrifice, because they saved our deen for us. Wa akhiru dawana, and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Inshallah, jazallah khair. Thank you very much for that spirited, beautiful speech. Those of you who are from Guyana, I know when I was growing up, this is the time of the year we would do the remembrance of what took place in Karbala. And it's true that today Sunni imams think if we talk about Karbala, we're Shia. It's not true. It's nonsense. That the family of the Prophet ﷺ is loved by the people, those of us who call ourselves Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, ardently and passionately. And you can feel from the talk that you just heard from our brother that understanding, that connection to the Prophet ﷺ and his family and to his descendants is a rich and a strong dynamic, and we need to revive that in Sunni Islam, particularly in the masjids. And we need to talk about it. And we see he's right. There's two narratives that we have existing. A narrative that, you know, people can chop other people's head off, shoot them and kill them. In the land of Iraq and Syria, and these things are happening these days, unfortunately, and these are we're living in the West here. We have to deal with that narrative. We have to try somehow to convince people that that's not our religion, that's not what we're talking about, right? So when you hear these stories, when you hear these incidents, these things that took place in our history, it did take place. And it's recorded. If the life of the Prophet ﷺ is recorded, every day of the life of the Prophet ﷺ is recorded and documented by numerous narrators. Not only Abu Huraira, not only Aisha, may Allah be pleased with them. Not only Umar and Uthman and Abu Bakr. No, but by hundreds of companions who lived, much less the years after the Prophet ﷺ, when the community were in the thousands. So these people can't lie. You don't make things like this up. This is real. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our Shaykh and bring him again in our midst and in our gathering so that we could, and may he go back safely to his country and salam to his father and his community and ask for dua for us here in Canada. We still have a queen as our head of state symbolically. So there's not much difference between, he doesn't really have, he already has a Canadian accent. You know, I didn't hear any British accent. I thought I would find it very difficult to understand what he was saying, but mashallah, he's very good. And the part about the philosophy and mashallah, that's so beautiful, and he's right that we need, with that kind of understanding, we can then talk to our children, because, you know, Richard Dawkins and these idiots that are out there and constantly in our face, you know, now we have atheists and they're getting together on Sundays and they're praying. I don't know. If you're an atheist, what are you praying? How are you praying? What are you praying to? To who? But we're going to play a little banjo and a little guitar and sing some songs about peace and love. They're just lost people. And our children will fall into that trap if they don't have this very, very rich and beautiful understanding that, and he studied philosophy. He has a degree that I envy, actually, to be honest, giving away a little bit of myself. It's a MacPhil from Oxford, of all places, which is, mashallah, you know, that's a prestigious degree to have, and our brother is coming from the foundations. He's read Western philosophy, and that's the kind of people we need. That's the kind of scholars we need, scholars who are familiar with what Western philosophy teaches and can also understand the epistemology of the divine, what the Quran and what our Prophet ﷺ offers. So may Allah bless him, bless all of you for coming here.